philosophy of clock building. What's it all about?
I hear you ask.
Well, I suppose it goes back to the 1980s when I was buying clocks, and sometimes I would buy bits of clocks hoping that I could get more bits to actually get them complete. And I couldn't always do that. I ended up with some cases lacking movements and some movements lacking cases. Sometimes almost complete clocks lacking bezels or hands. I lacked workshop facilities and I lacked the funds. It wasn't until the era of eBay that I started to think about this a bit more in depth, because I was able to get all the bits I needed to put things together. I was thinking in terms of not so much what kind of movement belongs to a certain case, or what kind of case belongs to a certain movement, but what could be made to fit where. I was thinking, how could I use bits in a way that makes the best, most efficient use of them? It wasn't until the eBay era, that's from 2001 onwards, that I started to think in terms of developing clocks as projects rather than just collecting clocks. Now, this wasn't the first, but it's certainly one of the earlier ones. This case was lying around in my attic for years before I developed the idea of putting cuckoo bells in it. It was lying on its back in the attic, looking empty and unwanted, and I was thinking I might put an OG movement in it, have the two weights going down in the middle. Then I thought, I could do better than that. I often get asked about this clock in particular. I get asked how this came about. Well, as it so happens, I had a few cuckoo bellows lying around in a drawer upstairs, and one day I was just looking at them and I played the notes on them, and I thought, if I get a few more of these, I can make a complete musical scale. Then I was thinking, how can I use this complete musical scale once I've got it? I thought the only thing I can use to actually utilise these bellows would be a Whittington chime movement. Then I just suddenly thought of this case. It's got a space in the bottom the right size for all these bellows, and I can link them through that rectangular hole, which you can't see, to the movement. So, I am notoriously slow at getting projects underway, but I did get this one put together reasonably quickly. I assembled the bellows as a collage, using little bits of wood to join them together. That's just stuck together with Evo stick, basically, and a few little wooden bridges where necessary. The high notes are all at the front, the low notes are at the back, which helps to link them to the hammer stems on the Whittington movement. I had to drill holes in some of the wooden bellows to tune them properly, and it took quite a lot of faffing around to actually get it to work properly. But now I'm very pleased with the results, and I'm pleased to say it has inspired a few people on YouTube to start thinking of building their own versions, which is a great honour, I must say. I also built a ship's clock, which hung here. Those are the original roll plugs. Yes, I sold it while I was travelling to see my fiancé. I needed the money. This is another project of mine. I bought this case many years ago when I was in my old flat, and it stood empty and upside down on the floor in my flat for years. Literally years. I'm not making that up. I wasn't sure what kind of movement to put in it. But then, as it happened, I needed spares for this clock, so I bought a scrap T&N master clock movement to get the spares off, and then I noticed that when I took those bits off it, there was enough left to have another complete clock. The only way I could do that is to put a cuckoo clock sprocket on the centre wheel, and I managed to get a small ratchet to put behind it in order to make Harrison's maintaining power, which is another nice addition to the plan. Also necessary because there's a Vienna deadbeat escapement. You don't want to wreck one of those while you're winding the clock up. The dial is just a sheet of brass and a chapter ring, which I've recently replaced. And of course, a seconds ring. That pendulum is just a striking clock pendulum. I sawed the hook part off and drilled a hole down it and put the steel rod into it. The other end of the steel rod has the hook part of the pendulum that hooks onto the pendulum leader, which is suspended on the back of the case. Now I had to think all this through because I needed to find a way of getting this clock put together in a way that it would work. The worst job was the bottom board because I had to fill in the old pendulum hole, which is in the wrong place, and cut a new one and then veneer over the bottom of it and drill two holes for the chain. That was a horrible task. After that, it was reasonably plain sailing.
And my Harrison's maintaining power works really well. See, I'm pulling the chain now. Second hand still turns. And yes, that tiny weight does drive this clock. It will go for more than 24 hours in the winding. I actually counted 27 hours because the other night I forgot to wind it up. It looks really good with that copper weight, especially when it's just been fully wound. So, an overview of the project. When I bought this case, it had an incomplete Korean 31-day movement in it, which is probably what this case was sold with new. But I think it looks better as a weight-driven hooded clock. And that is how I saw this case when I bought it. And I'm very pleased to say it's been a success. There have been moments, but overall, it's been a success. Sometimes my idea is, how big a movement can I fit into a small case? And I was rather pleased to discover that an HAC Westminster chiming movement fits perfectly in this tiny black wooden case. So all I had to do then was find five bells that would do the job and put the whole thing together. I think I was very lucky to find all the bits I needed. And that dial, that was originally a picture of a 400 day clock that I saved off eBay. I didn't buy the clock, just saved a picture. Airbrushed out the hands, printed it, photocopied it the right size on buttermilk coloured card, and got it laminated. It's just like the sort of dial that a clock of this style would have. So again, very pleased. My main idea was just to see how much movement can be fitted into a tiny case, and I reckon I succeeded with this one. As projects go, this one was a bit more subtle because that's an Austrian movement and I believe that to be an Austrian case. I was not too sure when I bought the case whether it was French or Austrian, but I have seen Austrian cases with these what looks like bear's feet on them and the huge wooden plinth. The actual design of the case with the wooden plinth, the bear's feet and the arch under the main part of the case, that is quite Austrian. The dial again, I didn't actually save, that was not an eBay rip-off, that was one I produced that on the computer. I had a minute ring saved and I just printed numerals. I don't know what font that is, but it looks like an Austrian dial. So I printed that out, photocopied it, and you know the rest. This one I had in my old flat for about 3 years with no movement in it. I wondered what kind of movement I would put in it. I was thinking of putting a three-weight chain-driven chiming movement in it. Then I saw the centre seconds movement that was being sold on eBay. I managed to buy it for £50 or thereabouts and discovered then that the pallets weren't right for the escapement and I couldn't get pallets that would fit it. So I just thought to myself, I'm going to have to grasshopper it. Now, how many of you have thought the same thing? You've taken a clock to bits and thought, I can't find pallets for this, I'll have to grasshopper it. I mean, let's face it, that happens all the time. Right, okay, well, I was lucky that whoever had built the movement had been an apprentice or something and had put all sorts of strange pivot holes where they weren't needed and filled some of them in again. There have been two different heights for the pallet pivots, which was particularly handy because the upper pivot height was just perfect for a grasshopper pallet assembly. It took me three attempts to make a grasshopper assembly that would actually work. It would work properly and consistently, I should say. But I can say now I'm very pleased with the result. I also put Bolton shutter maintaining power in it. I attached the Bolton shutter maintaining power to the wooden frame that the movement is fixed into rather than onto the movement itself, so that the originality of the movement isn't damaged in any way. I might rebuild that Bolton shutter maintaining power at some point, but for the moment it's working quite well. It's another example of a project clock. And it's intriguing to look back and think this was not how I originally intended that case to be used when I bought it. But I'm very happy with the result now. I wouldn't want to change it. This clock, however, I did buy with the intention of putting a grasshopper escapement in it. And I'd tried this with a similar clock a few years earlier. That experiment wasn't a success. So I redesigned the grasshopper escapement for this clock. And I was very pleased it worked so well. That's not the motion work this clock started off with. It had a double dial with the minutes in the centre and the hours at the bottom. But there were so many problems with that setup, I had to change it in the end. And I put in the motion work of an American military clock, which was designed for 24-hour time. So by a happy accident, I got this clock to be quite distinctive, shall we say. This clock has had quite a few modifications made to it. It's had a suspension spring added to it. It's maybe a bit too flimsy, actually. I should maybe put on a sturdier one. And also it has Harrison's maintaining power with an MDF ratchet wheel, which I filed myself. It's too dark to see, but there it is. A lot of people are obsessed with originality, and I don't really see that it's an issue. Of course, if you have a clock that is all original, then you should leave it that way. That's the way it was, that's the way it should be, and that's the way it's most authentic. But sometimes you can't have originality. Sometimes you've got a pile of bits and you don't necessarily know where those bits came from. You might have a movement without a case. You might have a case without a movement. And it's not always possible to tell what kind of movement was in that particular case or what kind of case that movement came out of. To me, that's just an excuse to develop something new and interesting. So the clock projects are still under development and they should be for quite some considerable time. Well, I hope you've enjoyed the show. My name's Tommy Wiley. Good night.